Okay, thank you. You may be seated. Governor, I will ask you to state your name, and I'm going to, and hopefully this was told to you, but the specific question before this committee is the ability of an attorney general to perform the duties of her office with an indefinitely suspended law license. So as chair, I will restrict your comments to that question. Your knowledge, I guess, as a former governor, I'm not sure what current knowledge you would have, but the question before the committee is her ability to perform the duties of attorney general with an indefinitely suspended law license. So in regard to that subject, you're willing to go ahead and make a statement, and then we'll have questions from the committee. Thank you, Governor. I'm not sure that, I think the mic.
Thank you, Senator. I do understand that, and I want to correct the Attorney General's transmission to you. I'm not here to support her position per se. I'm here to talk about the legal issue because I think it is an important legal issue. And I happen to come out on the issue that I would advise the committee and the Senate not to remove her based on the suspended license. But I'm not here for her or to support any particular position or individual. It's an interesting legal question, and it goes back to my time as District Attorney of Philadelphia. As you may know, I was District Attorney of Philadelphia for 8 years, from 1978 to 1986. Before that, I spent 9 years in the District Attorney's office, 2 as a summer intern, 7 as an assistant district attorney, including being chief of the homicide unit, perhaps the most impactful unit in the District Attorney's office. And during that time, I was in charge of an office of approximately 160 attorneys, about 85 or 90 county detectives, and about 100 support personnel of different, from secretaries to paralegals and the like. And the vast, vast majority, well over 95% of my duties, were administrative or policy setting or communications, PR, and outreach. In none of those functions, did I act as a lawyer. I acted as an elected official. I acted as a policymaker. The district attorney, as the attorney general, makes policy for that office. Let me just give you a quick rundown of of the things that I did. Administratively, I was actively engaged in the hiring, firing, and disciplining of attorneys and county detectives. And no one got hired without me interviewing them personally. No one got disciplined without me reviewing the charges and any statements they had. We had a hiring committee. In that committee, there were 4 lawyers and 2 non-lawyers. I reviewed their decisions, reviewed their recommendations, and made the ultimate decision after I interviewed all the prospective attorneys. Secondly, I had budgetary responsibility, and so hiring decisions, no need for me to have been a lawyer. I brought the same common sense to that decision-making process as I did as mayor and governor. Budget. I intimately involved in the preparation of the yearly budget. I was intimately involved in decisions on ongoing budget questions and how much money we could spend if we were running a deficit in the middle of the year, how we corrected it. And I was the spokesman for us in City Council. I testified in front of City Council on our budget request, why we needed this amount of money for this function, why we needed that amount of money for that function. And I often would, after City Council would rule, I would take my appeal to the mayor. Mayor Rizzo was mayor for my first 2 years as district attorney, and if council had turned my request down, I would go to see Mayor Rizzo, and I would tell him, Mayor, it's a war out there, and he would pound the desk, and I would get everything that I wanted. Nowhere in those budgetary discussions was it necessary for me to be a lawyer. It was necessary for me to have the sense and the policy-making ability that I did have as mayor and governor. Where the office should be. During my 8 years as district attorney, we relocated our office 3 times. We were in, when I became district attorney, we were in a fancy downtown office building known in Philadelphia as the Clothespin Building. They wanted us to re-up our lease, but they charged us an inordinate amount of money, and I thought a public office should not be in a fancy building like that, paying an inordinate amount of money, and I made the decision to move. That decision didn't require any legal ability or legal skill. It required administrative skill, policy, and judgment, the same that I hope that I showed as mayor and governor. Training. When I became district attorney, I didn't think the training that our new assistant district attorneys received was adequate. So I set up a training program. I got money from council to build a mock courtroom with videotape, and that whole upgrading of our training function was done by me in an administrative capacity. I didn't need to be a lawyer to know that we needed that function. Salaries and promotions. I was intimately involved in what's very important to our attorneys, as well as our detectives and support personnel, what salaries they were going to be paid initially, when they would get increases in salaries, when they would get promotions from unit to unit. I didn't need to be a lawyer to assess the value of the individuals and their performance, and I made those decisions as an administrator. Deployment. How many attorneys do I give to the homicide division? How many attorneys do I give to the major crimes division? How many attorneys to the motions division? How many attorneys to the appeals division? Those are administrative decisions, and I didn't need to be a lawyer to carry out those decisions. So grants. We were very active in seeking grants from foundations, from federal government, the federal government, the state government. I personally supervised the preparation of those grant requests, and often I would come and appear before those bodies and make the requests for grants. I didn't need to be a lawyer to do that. I did the same thing as mayor and later as governor, and I wasn't acting as a lawyer. That's about 90% of my job right there. Not 90%, about 80% of my job right there was administrative, and those are the major functions. I didn't need to be a lawyer for any of them. Second function I did was what I call the PR function, the communications function. So, for example, one of the great communications, and you all know this because you do the same as I did when I was DA, mayor, or governor, is communicating with the public. And to that end, mail. I read every piece of mail I received as district attorney, passed it on to the appropriate person, answered. Often I would dictate letters in response to the citizens' letters that I received. I didn't act as a lawyer in formulating those responses or sending out those letters to be answered by others. That was purely a way of having significant outreach with some of my constituents. Secondly, I made speeches. I made speeches at breakfast, I made speeches at lunchtime, and I made speeches at night. And those speeches were to rally support for some of the initiatives that we wanted to do as an office. I didn't need to be a lawyer to make those speeches any more than I did when I was mayor or governor. The third thing I did was I instituted something called Wednesday Night Talk to the DA. It had never been done before, but I sat in my office from 6 to 11 on Wednesday nights and would meet with any citizen who wanted to see me about an issue, about a concern, et cetera. I did this throughout most of my 8 years as district attorney. I didn't need to be a lawyer to hear those complaints and to try to find ways to rectify the things that the citizens were complaining about. Press conferences. I did press conferences because press conferences, as all of you know, is the way that we communicate to our constituents what we're doing, how we're doing it, why we're doing it. And I didn't need to be a lawyer or to employ legal skills to do press conferences. I started a newsletter that we sent to community groups, and in Philadelphia there are some 300 plus community groups on a monthly basis. I did it to inform and continue good outreach and solicit suggestions, but I also did it to push for policy initiatives that we were trying to do to get citizens' support. That was a very important component of what I did. And if you combine that with my administrative function, I'd say I'm up to about 90% of my functions. Lastly, I made policy decisions. And those policy decisions were very significant. I decided that we needed new units when I became district attorney, and sometimes in the middle of my service as district attorney. So, for example, I started the first police brutality unit to investigate issues of police brutality that the district attorney's office ever had. I didn't do that because I thought it was legally required. I did it because I thought it was good policy. And when you think of what's happening today, it was very good policy at the time. I instituted a rape unit with specially trained lawyers to try rape cases. They did nothing else. I did it because I didn't think that victims of sexual assault were getting proper handling in the court system. I was persuaded to do this by the Citizens Against Rape, and I didn't need to be a lawyer to know that they weren't getting proper treatment in the courts. So I produced a new unit. In the middle of my time as district attorney, I wasn't satisfied that we were getting significantly long sentences for repeat offenders. So I established a career criminal unit. I got a federal grant for the career criminal unit, and we went forward and was eminently successful in dramatically increasing the sentences given to recidivistic career criminals. Didn't need to be a lawyer to make that judgment. The second thing I did in the policy realm was legislation. So I don't think any of you were here when Governor Thornburg was governor, but I proposed to Governor Thornburg that we institute a mandatory minimum sentence for five specific crimes of violence, so that judges could be free to give more. So assume someone was guilty of an aggravated assault with a firearm hit, against a policeman. Calls for 10 to 20 years as a maximum, but no judge could give less than 5 years. Mandatory minimums, not maximums. And I proposed the legislation to Governor Thornburg. We submitted legislation to Governor Thornburg. I lobbied for the legislation, not only with Governor Thornburg, with members of the legislature. We created public outcry to support that legislation. It got passed, and it is still on the books today. Didn't need to be a lawyer to do that function. Death penalty cases. I had a rule in the office, and this is an interesting aspect, that no one could seek the death penalty when we got a first-degree murder conviction without first coming to see me. They would come to see me with the chief of the homicide unit. They would review the facts, review the background of the offender. If there were any extenuating circumstances, they would present them to me. And as a policy, I wanted to limit the number of first-degree murder cases that we sought the death penalty in. Because in Philadelphia during my first year as district attorney, for example, we had over 100 first-degree murder convictions. I wanted to limit them to the most egregious cases with the most egregious offenders. Didn't need to be a lawyer to do that. I needed to be a policymaker to decide how much, when, where, how egregious those were. The law had all been settled. The conviction was already returned. Lastly, enforcement of laws. When I became district attorney, there was a law in the books called sodomy. Legislature, I don't know if any of you voted to repeal that law, but you eventually did repeal the sodomy law. And sodomy would, in those days, be committed by two adults who were doing what were called unnatural sex acts, and they were guilty of sodomy. That would include people having lesbian and gay sex. The police would, because the law was on the books, the police would arrest those people if they saw them doing it, and I decided that that wasn't a good use of police time. I decided that as long as it was consenting adults, there was no governmental policy that justified the allocation of resources. I made that decision not as a lawyer, but as a policymaker. That was about 98% of my job. I want to refer, you asked Mr. Decker some very good questions. You went through that list and asked, did the Attorney General, was she authorized to do this? Was she authorized to do that? I just wrote down three of them real quickly. One was, is she authorized to bring suit? Yes, the Attorney General, even in her status, could bring suit because often the decision to bring suit is not a legal one. It's a policy. So as you may be aware, I don't know if the Attorney General joined in this, but several district attorneys sued Governor Wolf when he instituted the moratorium on the death penalty. They sued him and said he didn't have the power to do it. That's a legal decision in the sense that they thought he didn't have the legal power to do it, but it was a policy decision to see whether you'd bring that suit or join that suit. And the policy decision would have been tempered by the fact that there was a committee that was reviewing the appropriateness of the death penalty, how the death penalty had been applied in Pennsylvania. And had I been district attorney of Philadelphia at that time, I would have agreed that we should wait until that commission came back with its report. Not as a lawyer, but because I'd be interested, as you are and you are, and I don't know how many lawyers are on the bench, but in the way that the death penalty is being applied in Pennsylvania, I'd be interested in seeing all those facts, statistics, and examples. You asked if it was okay for the Attorney General, could the Attorney General make a decision to join amicus briefs? And again, often those are policy decisions, not legal decisions. So as you know, many attorney generals across the United States decided to file a lawsuit or come in as amicus saying that the Affordable Care Act was unconstitutional. That was a policy decision as well as a legal decision. The policy was whether the Affordable Care Act was in fact something good or bad for the citizens of the state. Those decisions were made on policy, and to be frank, when you look at who joined and who didn't, on politics, not on legal decisions. You asked about wiretap decisions. Often the decision on wiretap is not a legal decision. It's, again, a policy decision. So, for example, if someone came to me and I was the DA and said, we have an indication that the mayor has been betting on or running a betting consortium on sports, and we want to wiretap his office to get evidence of this so we can prosecute him. Well, as District Attorney of Philadelphia, I wouldn't authorize a wiretap against the mayor, even if it was legally okay to do it, because it's a policy decision. You don't put a wiretap in the mayor's office for running a sports betting pool. So what I'm saying is there are some decisions that are mixtures between legal decisions and policy decisions, but 97% of the work of a prosecutor in a major office inherently has to be administration, policy, communications, and outreach, at least 97%. And I think that's the case with an office as big as the Attorney General's office here in Pennsylvania. I would also say, in closing, and then I'm happy to answer any questions, I think we're in a very difficult position because, as you know, the Attorney General has sought reinstatement of her license from the Supreme Court. There now is almost an entirely new Supreme Court from the one that suspended her. What were to happen if this committee recommended that she be removed on this issue? The Senate as a whole voted to remove her. And then a week later, the Supreme Court decided that they were going to reinstate her license. Does her license get reinstated automatically? Do we have to come back to the Senate for action? How do you frame your decision? Are you removing her as long as her license remains suspended? It's a very difficult question because she's going before a new court, at least three judges who've never heard this issue before. I would urge you not to take action at all, but certainly not to take action until the Supreme Court has ruled on her request. And lastly, let me say this. I know that this is a controversial subject. I care very much about the conduct of public officials and law enforcement officials. I was a law enforcement official for 18 years of my life. I was a public official for 16 years of my life. I care very deeply about the reputation, and there's been a lot of roads gone down here. And if you believe that the Attorney General's conduct was egregious, the proper remedy is not this one, because this one is clouded. It's not going to ever be clear. It hasn't been used for 100 years. The proper remedy is impeachment. And I would urge you to step back and begin the impeachment process where all of this can be heard. But to remove her on this issue, where I think She probably has the right side of the argument, that she can continue to function and do her job, and that citizens of Pennsylvania wouldn't suffer, I think would be the wrong thing to do. And I thank you for the opportunity to express my opinion.
Thank you for your testimony. A couple of questions, and we'll ask committee members for questions as well. Just to clarify, you were the district attorney in Philadelphia County from 1978 to 1986?
The elected district attorney, right.
All right, so you were last in office about 30 years ago.
Right, and I served for 9 years as an assistant before that under Arlen Specter, and Arlen Specter, interestingly, never overruled my judgment on any decision I made as chief of homicide. Interesting. Right. And I don't know if any of you ever worked for Arlen Specter, but that's saying a lot.
You currently have a law license?
Oh, yeah.
Has your law license ever been suspended?
No.
Okay.
But interesting you ask that, because I was thinking on the way up, you can lose your law license in Pennsylvania if you don't fulfill your CLE requirements. The lawyers on the panel know what I'm talking about that. Let's assume for a second that we had a district attorney or attorney general who just was too busy or thought the CLE requirements were, you know, not important, et cetera, and didn't fulfill the requirements of the CLE. And the court, after several warnings, decides they had no recourse but to suspend her or to suspend him. Would we be having these hearings if someone had a suspended license because they didn't fulfill their CLE requirements? Of course not. You're having these hearings because of the other things that Kathleen Kane is charged with doing. Do it the right way. Impeach her, if that's what you believe.
Yeah, and that's apples and oranges, Governor. As you indicate, there are several warnings that take place. It's, I think, about a 90 or 120-day period that you have in order to get those CLE requirements.
And let's assume, for some reason, the office holder doesn't do it.
It's apples and oranges.
So. No, it's not apples and oranges. It's a suspended license. You're saying you can't be an office holder in a law enforcement office with a suspended license. Would you really suspend someone who lost their license
after several warnings and not doing
CLE? You would?
I
don't think so.
Well, it's apples and oranges. Let me just, we had a panel here of district attorneys. District Attorney Heckler from Bucks County, District Attorney Adams from Berks County, District Attorney Somerset from Somerset County. They all indicated that they would not be able to perform the overwhelming majority of functions of their office with a suspended law license. So you're going to disagree with all three of them?
I am, and I do it respectfully, but I will say that none of those offices are anywhere in scope of the District Attorney's Office of Philadelphia. The only office, the only two offices that are even close to the Attorney General are the District Attorney of Allegheny County and the District Attorney of Philadelphia. Senator, I never tried a case, and I never handled an appeal in my 8 years as the elected District Attorney.
Yeah, and no offense. I mean, you very clearly stated that while you were a District Attorney, you were more a public official than you were a District Attorney. And you're obviously very proud of that, and that's very interesting.
I was a very good District Attorney, and the District Attorney's Office
just a second.
Very,
you said you were very much a public official, not
right.
A District Attorney. We happen to have a panel here of three folks that were district attorneys.
I was also
a district
attorney.
And are very proud of the fact that they involved themselves on the criminal type of cases and the wiretaps and the presentments and the arrests and stuff like that. You obviously, while you were district attorney, decided not to do any of that. Is that correct?
Because of the scope of the office. None of those offices have anywhere close to the number of people, number of cases that the Attorney General or the District Attorney of
Philadelphia. So if we were to ask the District Attorney from Philadelphia, and if we were to ask the District Attorney from Allegheny County, Mr. Zappala, who I think is going to be a candidate for Attorney General, they would indicate that they're strictly public officials and they're not district attorneys and they don't make decisions in regard to
the
criminal cases. Is that correct?
The public office that they hold is district attorney.
Right. And so right now, the current DA from Philly and the current DA from Allegheny County, to the best of your knowledge, make public decisions. They don't make any district attorney type of criminal decisions or legal decisions on a day-to-day basis.
Deciding whether to prosecute sodomy against two consenting adults is a district attorney decision. But what I'm telling you is it's driven by policy. And to make decisions based on policy. You don't necessarily have to be a lawyer with an active license.
Let me give you a hypothetical. Let's say that there is an attorney general out there that was going to or had the opportunity to prosecute some state representatives or elected officials. And let's say they decide not to do that. So let's just say in the hypothetical that there was a county district attorney that asked for that information, looked and reviewed the cases, and decided to go ahead and prosecute. They're making that decision on a public official basis, or they're making that decision on a legal basis?
Probably a little of both.
All right. So there would have to be a legal basis, and you'd have to have an attorney. Do you have to be an attorney to be a district attorney?
Yes. But there's nowhere that says if you have your license suspended, you're automatically disqualified from office.
So in your opinion, if a district attorney has a suspended law license, they could continue to operate?
I think so. And by the way, if the Senate is so clear in your desire to do that, just pass a law.
Well, again,
saying if any attorney, district attorney, attorney general has their license to practice law suspended, they will forfeit their office. That's easy. Vote it.
So if the Philadelphia district attorney has a suspended law license, continue to operate and prosecute and do everything else?
Continue to be the elected head of the office, yes.
And make decisions in regard to the hypothetical that I just gave you in regard to pursuing cases against the state representatives and
yes,
judges and that sort of thing.
Because as district attorney, you rely, in a large office, you rely on your appeals chief, your motions chief, your homicide chief, as I said.
And you're not making any legal?
Our inspector never overruled
a legal decision.
Any decision that I made. The evidence was sufficient to bring charges against an individual.
And they didn't use their legal. He didn't use his legal background to do that.
He essentially delegated on a day-to-day basis his judgment to my recommendation.
He didn't use his legal.
I don't know.
Training to do that.
I don't know.
You didn't use your legal training to do that at all. You were just a public official.
I did as the chief of the homicide unit, as an assistant DA. Absolutely.
But when you were district attorney, you didn't use your legal opinion to make decisions as to whether to pursue cases or not?
Some in the small percentage of cases that
How many cases in a year, how many cases were prosecuted in Philadelphia County when you were there 30 years ago?
About 35,000.
35,000?
Yeah.
All right. And you weren't involved in any of those, making decisions as to whether to prosecute or not?
Probably.
A handful?
20 to 30.
Okay. So again, you were, I get it.
Involved
I get
in the
it.
Decision,
were,
but that doesn't necessarily mean that I used legal judgment. I often used policy judgment. Like I said, the decision to bring charges against two consenting adults for sodomy, that's not a legal
decision. You did not review the legal statute in order to make a decision?
No. I knew the law was clear.
So you went against the law?
I made a policy decision. Sure. District attorneys do not prosecute every case on the books. You know why, Senator? Because the offices couldn't function. They make decisions all the time based on policy. Yes, there's evidence against Mary Smith, but it's not significant enough for us to prosecute, to waste our court time prosecuting. We'll put her in the ARD program, or we'll just drop charges. In fact, one of the things I did as District Attorney of Philadelphia is I instituted a charging unit. And I got from the charging responsibility. So now in Philadelphia, the police no longer decide what charges to place on an individual. The district attorney's office does. And we routinely...
So lawyers do?
But we routinely...
Lawyers do?
Yeah, lawyers do.
Okay.
But we routinely make decisions not to charge someone when it's clear that they violated the law. We don't charge people in Philadelphia, for example, for possession of a small amount of marijuana because the decision is made not to waste court time on that. That's not a legal decision. That's a policy decision. Look, the answer is your complaint with Kathleen Kane isn't that she has a suspended license. Your complaint with Kathleen Kane is her conduct. Impeach her.
That is not the issue before this committee.
I agree. But I'm just giving you my two cents. Yeah, I don't get the chance often anymore.
That's apparent. Senator Haywood followed by Senator Scarnati.
Thank you very much. We've had some analogies used in some prior hearings. One was a barbershop analogy. So the barbershop analogy went pretty much as follows. If a barber loses their license, then they can't cut hair. And so that analogy was extended to the Attorney General's office. The Attorney General's office can't practice law, then what's she doing there? Now, I've heard you say pretty much this large number of non-legal responsibilities, which is pretty much what the Chief of Staff said prior to your arrival. What I'd like to get, and what I've been trying to get a sense of, is the operation of some of these offices. When you were governor, I'm assuming you had some interaction with the, whoever was the Attorney General at that time?
I did, Attorney General Corbett.
And at that time, did you have, would you say mostly policy conversations with him, or they were mostly legal determinations?
Exclusively policy.
Exclusively policy. And for what, was this a frequent kind of conversation, or was this?
I would speak to the general 10 or 20 times a year.
And in the 10 or 20 times, you say you never had a legal, they're all policy?
All policy. Questions of budget, questions of do we want to preempt and take over the civil case from him, things like that.
Thank you.
Senator Scarnati, followed by Senator Schwenk.
Well, thank you. Good afternoon, Governor.
Good to see you, Senator.
Nice to see you. You're looking well. So under your testimony,
you can ask me about the budget.
We'll do that in the other room. So under your testimony, as you know, I'm not an attorney, but it appears I could be a district attorney.
Well, you only couldn't because the law says you have to be an attorney.
Yeah.
But by the way, do you know, Senator, that you don't have to be an attorney to be a Supreme Court justice?
Well, it sounds, I mean, I listened to your testimony of, I didn't need to be an attorney. I did this, but I didn't need to be an attorney. It almost sounded like the red buttons and I didn't get a dinner. You know, you performed all these functions as DA, but you didn't do it as a lawyer. They were functions of public relations. It almost sounded like, and don't take this with any disrespect, but it sounds like you're running for mayor while you're a DA.
No, no. Again, administrating a large office is a very important function. It's the key to whether that office can be effective. But what I said, I'm sorry if I didn't say it well enough or succinctly enough, what I said is I didn't use any legal judgment in the administration of the office. I used policy judgment, just as I did when I was mayor or governor. You don't, I was a lawyer and I was admitted to practice, but I didn't use those legal skills in administration.
But isn't it fair to say, though, the legal skills come into play on the big issues? The big issues, while you were DA, that you, the 20 or 30 you made decisions on, those were because of your you know, experience as a prosecutor, experience as an attorney.
To some degree, but they were the biggest decisions were policy decisions. Like, for example, starting a police brutality unit.
Okay, but
you
have
no idea how difficult a decision that was back in 1978 in Philadelphia.
But on these big issues, let's take a big issue that happened.
That's as big as
okay.
A dot.
Well, let's talk about a big issue in Philadelphia. Back in, I think it was May 13th, 1985. That's when the shootout, the bombing, and the
right.
Fire and the deaths at the Move House, okay? Who made the decisions on who to investigate that? Who made that decision?
On who to investigate?
Whether or not to investigate that the shootings, the bombings, the fire and the deaths at the Move House on May 13th, 1985. Who made the decision not to investigate that?
Well, there was investigation on part of it, and part of it we deferred to the federal prosecutor. I made the decision to defer to the federal prosecutor.
And that's right. Your quote,
that wasn't a legal decision.
Well, I'm confused. Your quote in the Philly paper of September 20th, 1991 was, I made that decision in 2 weeks. You
right,
made that decision.
I made it, but not necessarily as a lawyer.
Well, you didn't make it as a lawyer
to
not
to
investigate
defer
bombings, fires, shootouts, and deaths?
I made the decision that, given our relationship with the police at the time, it would be better, and given the fact that the federal attorney had said they were willing to investigate, that from a policy matter, rather than have us and the police going at each other at that level, that the federal attorney would go ahead and do that investigation.
Would you be comfortable with a non-attorney, non-licensed attorney making that decision? Is the public served? Is the public served with decisions such as this had you not been an attorney?
But the question is, did I use...
No, the question legal. Is... No, let me frame the question better then. You had to have used your legal and prosecutorial background to make the decision whether or not to prosecute and investigate that bombing and shooting.
My decision was made based on the fact that the federal attorney, U.S. attorney, was going to investigate, and that I thought it was better for the administration of justice that the federal U.S. attorney do it than the DA's office. That was not based on any legal opinion.
No legal opinion?
No. Legally, someone should have investigated it. And the question was, as a policy decision, who was the better office to investigate it?
But you said you made the decision in 2 weeks.
I made the decision.
You made that decision.
Absolutely.
And you did not make that one bit on the fact of your legal background. You made it purely on a is it public relations background?
A policy decision.
Policy.
Senator, let me go again. Given the relationship between the Philadelphia Police and the district attorney's office at that time, I made the decision that we'd be better off, and given the fact that the United States attorney was going to investigate, I made the decision that it was better for the administration of justice in Philadelphia County that the U.S. attorney do it, not the district
attorney. I accept that answer, but our attorney general can't do that. I accept your answer. Thank you, Governor.
Senator Schwenk, followed by Senator Yaw.
Thank you, Senator Gordner. Good to see you, Governor Rendell.
Yeah.
Thank you. Pretty good memory and recall.
I haven't liked
a lot of
Joe
activities.
Yet.
He must have drawn that back out of you to see Senator Scarnati. Look, I'm not interested in laying any traps for you or to try. I'm not a lawyer. And what I'm really most interested in is what you think exactly this Supreme Court order means in terms of what the Attorney General can do or can't do. To me, quite frankly, it doesn't mean that all the legal knowledge, all of her training, all of her education is just blown out of her head. It is still there.
Right.
But what specifically can she do, in your opinion, that stays within the letter of the order?
All of the administrative policy, communications, outreach functions of the Attorney General's office that my guess is are the same 97% as they were when I was district attorney.
So what you're saying is that the office can function even if she doesn't have a license? That the duties that the people of Pennsylvania are still being served, it's extraordinary, certainly it is, and maybe she can't sign something, but...
But someone can.
Yeah.
And I think Senator Yaw asked a very interesting question about the lawsuit brought by the criminal defense lawyers. That's a spurious lawsuit. Anybody could have told you that they had about as much chance of succeeding as... It wasn't. I mean, you're going to throw something out because... Kathleen Kane didn't bring it, and her first deputy or executive deputy signed the indictment? Of course not.
So you had pretty good recall of what you did.
I never signed an indictment. The head of the indictment division signed every indictment. I never signed one.
So you had pretty good recall of what happened in the district attorney's office. And then when you were serving as a governor and you worked with an attorney general, your independent offices,
right.
Obviously. But in your recollection, what were the specific duties of the Attorney General, and was the Attorney General as intimately involved in all of the details of the office, the operations of the office? That's pretty broad, but...
And I couldn't really tell you that. I don't know how Governor Corbett ran his office. Some people get it. Some people are... Jimmy Carter, they said, used to decide who could use the White House tennis court. He was not a very good delegator. Other elected officials are good delegators. I couldn't tell you about the inner workings of Governor Corbett's office, but I will tell you that when Governor Corbett and I discussed, when he called me to discuss the issues, they were all policy considerations. We didn't sit around and say, well, the Supreme Court said this in Jones versus Dubrow. We didn't do it. They were policy considerations.
Does making policy decisions violate the Supreme Court order?
No, absolutely not.
So the Attorney General is operating with appropriately if she's involved in policy decisions?
Sure. If she decided to, let's say, switch a third of the personnel from the Public Protection Unit to the Drug Enforcement Unit, that's a policy decision, and she certainly has absolute right, even under the Supreme Court order, to do just that.
Would your opinion be the same if she were disbarred rather than just having a suspended license? What would be the difference you would see in what she could do or could not do?
Well, because if you're disbarred, you're no longer an attorney.
Correct.
If you have a suspended license, you're still an attorney. And then, so if you're disbarred, you couldn't fulfill the constitutional requirement. Or in the case of the district attorney's office, the home rule charter requirement that you be an attorney.
But on the state level, it's the state constitution that says that you must be an attorney.
Right.
And if you're disbarred, you no longer are an attorney. But she's not disbarred.
And there's I have no clue what the Supreme Court's going to do, but there's a chance in 4 or 5 weeks she's going to be reinstated. And then what would happen then?
In your testimony, you mentioned that you didn't think we should move forward on this action, and you then did make the argument about what would happen if the Supreme Court does reverse that decision. Is that what you were basing that on, or is there something else there?
No, I mean, it would be chaotic. And again, would you, and I don't know what the Senate at large would do or this committee would do, but would you frame your order as long as she has a suspended license, Kathleen King can no longer serve as Attorney General, so that if the court reinstates her license, she becomes Attorney General again? I don't know what you'd do. And then you'd have the Senate throwing her out and the Supreme Court reinstating her license. What would the law be on that? Who would decide what happens next? It would add to the chaos. Senators, impeach her. If your main complaint is the way she has conducted herself in office, impeach her. Don't use this method.
Thank you, Governor.
Senator Yaw, followed by Senator Baker.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, Governor, for being here. You've heard about the three DAs that were here and sat in those chairs, and they were. It was a very good cross-section of the way I think that district attorney's offices are operated in the state. One of them was very similar to apparently the way you operated the district attorney's office in Philadelphia, purely administrative, or it never went to court. One person was in court all the time, handled all the cases, and then one in the middle, actually wherever you sat, was kind of the person. Well, they did a little bit of everything, but didn't go to court too much, but they still went to court. But the common thread that they all had is that even though they may not go to court, they all had the legal ability to go to court if they had to. Even the administrator said, now, and I assume from what you said when you were the district attorney of Philadelphia, even though you didn't go to court, and that's fine. District attorney's office has always been, in the legal world, that's the best job in anywhere because you have no supervisor except to get elected every once in a while. But you can run the office any way you want. But you still had the ability, if push came to shove, you could go to court. You could go to an appellate argument. You could go to a post-conviction hearing or anything.
Sure.
So, and that's where my problem comes up in this case. And you were here present, I know, in the room when I asked the question about the Commonwealth Attorneys Act, which specifically draws a distinction between the Attorney General, which it says the Attorney General, the Office of Attorney General shall be an independent department headed by the Attorney General, draws a distinction between the two. And then the very first one involving legal advice, it says, upon the request of the governor or the head of any Commonwealth agency, the Attorney General shall furnish legal advice concerning any matter or issue arising in connection with the exercise of the official power or the performance of the official duties of the governor or agency. Since a suspended lawyer cannot give legal advice, the Attorney General in Pennsylvania is a suspended lawyer, then how do we get around the fact that the current Attorney General cannot meet the statutory requirement of giving legal advice to the governor?
I think the phrase Attorney General there applies. I know it says Attorney General, not Attorney General's office, but it applies to the Attorney General's office. So, for example, when I was chief of homicide, I did try cases, and I would come in and I would say, if it pleases the court, my name is Edward Rendell, assistant district attorney, chief of the homicide unit, representing the district attorney's office and the Commonwealth. So, and when Governor Corbett would ask questions to me that required, and often, most often it never happened, but required us to make a legal judgment, I would have my chief counsel, either Leslie Miller or Barbara Adams, respond. I wouldn't respond. So I think as long as there's, the only way it would become relevant, the ability of the Attorney General or the District Attorney to go to court, is if something happened and everyone else in the office was either wiped out or not there or whatever. That's the only way it would be relevant. When an assistant DA goes to court, an assistant Attorney General goes to court, they're representing the Attorney General's office. And as long as the office has that capacity, it can function.
Well, I guess I disagree with you a little bit, because there are numerous places in the Commonwealth's Attorneys Act where, unfortunately, the gender at the time it was written, it refers to he shall or matters being apparently for his review. That specifies, that's a little bit different. And the way I look at both the offices of district attorney and the Commonwealth and the Attorney General is I assume that there's nobody else in that office but that one person. That's the way the statutes are all written. Now, obviously, they have the authority to hire enough people under them.
Who act for them.
To act for them. But the way the statutes are written is that this is the only person in that office, and that person has to have all the qualifications to meet the duties that are imposed either by the Constitution or by statute for that office.
And you think, for example, if the response to the question was the Attorney General or the DA gave a response that said, here's a memorandum from my office saying, a legal opinion saying you can do it. I did that. I'm the Attorney General. I gave the answer. It's a memorandum signed by Chief of the Appeals Division.
Well, that raises the argument, though, is you have to possess all the powers in that office in order to be able to give them to somebody else.
You're saying the Attorney General is required by the Commonwealth Attorneys Act to give an opinion. Hands in a memorandum prepared by the Chief of the Appeals Division says, this is a memorandum from the Attorney General's office. I am providing you with it.
Yeah, I look at it a little bit more narrowly, like in a major law firm, that somebody asks you for an opinion, and they ask you, and you say, I'm going to have three associates do the research and draft a letter for me, and I'll sign it.
Let's assume a client came into the head of a major law firm, and I now work for a major law firm, and said, I want you to tell me whether, I want you to give us an opinion saying that what we're doing is legal. So often the SEC requires that. The managing partner 6 weeks later calls back and says, here's an opinion written by Jake Schrager of our office, who's an expert in this field of law, saying it is lawful. It's the opinion of the Jones, Smith, and McGagee law firm.
That's a different situation.
No, I think it's analogous.
Well, I know, but if I ask for your opinion, I want your opinion, and that's what I think that the Commonwealth Attorneys Act says. I want your opinion.
When you go,
I don't want the opinion of somebody else in your office. I understand you're going to go do research and have somebody else do it for you. I want yours. I want your name on the line.
In my district, well, the office's name is on the line, and therefore my name's on the line. But in my time as district attorney, when we were asked for an advisory opinion or asked for this or this, I don't think I ever answered that solely by myself. I always answered it based on research of the people who were the experts in that particular area.
All right. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Senator Baker.
Thank you. Good afternoon, Governor. You have been asked or delegated by the Attorney General to appear today, and I just want to establish on the record, are you appearing here as her lawyer, or are you appearing here as a private citizen who is a former public official? Were you asked by the Attorney General, or did you offer to appear today on her behalf?
I think I made the mistake of answering a question from the press saying I thought that you didn't have to be a lawyer with an active license to continue being an attorney general. And as a result of that, being in the press, the attorney general or one of her representatives called me and said, is that your feeling?
Was it Mr. Ardo who asked you to appear?
Don't really remember. But it may have been the general herself, it may have been Mr. Ardo, it may have been someone else. But
you are not acting today in the capacity as a lawyer on her behalf,
no,
but as a private citizen.
I tried to make it
and
clear.
Former public official.
I tried to make it clear at the beginning of my testimony. I'm not here to take sides in the personal aspect of this. I'm just giving my opinion of what the law requires or doesn't require.
Sure, and as I listen
and
to
by the
you,
way, also as someone, one of the things I've tried to do as governor, and you've probably noticed it because I write to you all on occasion my opinion about stuff, like the transportation bill, I said to myself that as long as I have the capacity to do so, I'm going to try to weigh in on issues of public concern. I do so on legislation, I do so on administrative issues in Harrisburg, and I am here because this is an issue that concerns me, and I really deeply believe that this is not the proper way to go, that there are other better avenues to pursue.
I appreciate that. You've established, and I've listened to you say, that much of the duties and functions both in the Office of Attorney General and in District Attorney's Office are administrative, but the law requires the district attorney to be admitted before the Supreme Court. The law requires, and the Constitution requires, that the attorney general be a lawyer. So are you recommending to us today that both of these offices don't need lawyers to run them?
No, that could only
You're offering significant policy, and as I'm listening to you, it's pretty clear that you're suggesting that the office doesn't necessarily need that to function. Am I incorrect in that assumption?
Yeah, I thought I apologize if I didn't say it precisely enough, but no, I'm here to answer the very narrow question. Does an attorney who's had license suspended have the power to remain as the head elected official of an office?
The rules for suspended lawyers are pretty clear. They cannot represent the clients that they previously represented. The client of the Office of Attorney General is, in fact, the Commonwealth. I listened to you earlier about the interactions with Governor Corbett, and you said all of it was policy. I know one of your major policy initiatives was the Growing Greener Initiative. That was a bond executed through the Commonwealth that we heard from the Office of Attorney General that only an Attorney General can execute and sign. So clearly there are some situations here that differ and would require the Attorney General to sign them. And I'm just using one of your major policy initiatives that you were proud of.
Let's take the bond issue as an example. Let's assume the Attorney General had a stroke and was incapacitated. Bond issue had a time deadline. It had to go to the market a week after the stroke. If the Deputy Attorney General signed that bond issue, believe me, it would be legal.
That would be a vacancy in office, and it would fall to the first deputy. That would be my understanding of how that would operate. Let me ask you, you have been pretty clear today in saying that you believe that impeachment is the appropriate mechanism to address the situation. Do you believe the Senate has the authority to act under the reasonable clause?
Act on its own?
To conduct what we're doing. Do you believe we're doing something that's proper and in the purview and jurisdiction of the Senate to act?
I haven't given it much thought, but I probably believe you have the purview and the ability to act. I'm just urging that you don't act.
Thank you.
Governor, thank you for your testimony.
Thank you very much.
This hearing is in recess.
I'd like to say I miss all of you, but I don't like to lie.
The hearing is closed.